When I was 7, Gardener's Question Time came to the village of Bedley, Oxfordshire, and I asked a question. What methods, I wondered in my shrill soprano, did members of the panel employ to deal with the perennial problem of snails? The audience laughed. My father had said they would, and the panel spoke. One said traps scraped clean daily, another moats filled with beer. Copper barriers react with slime and electrocute, the third one said. They all agreed that Bordeaux mixture repels when applied to trunks and sheds, and iron phosphates starve them slowly. My father sat beside me, eyes all twinkly. And when the chairman turned to me for my response, my father rose and said, "Hand picking is the best and most efficient method. First water thoroughly the infested beds in late afternoon, then wait. Enjoy slow drinks and a family dinner. Smile, be happy, make love to your wife. After dark, wake one small boy."
"Alex?"
"And take him out into your garden. Drawn to the surface of the wet flower beds, the snails can now be located with a flashlight and drowned in soapy water or crushed."
"Good boy. Bad snails."
Repeated twice a week, this eco-friendly procedure not only avoids harmful chemicals, it provides a stimulating introduction into the ways of the English garden and a vital form of bonding between a father and his son.
"What do you mean, you feel sick? Right. Let's go wake up your mother."
At Home with the Snails, written by Gerard Foster, starring Geoffrey Palmer and Angela Thorne.
"This is my conservatory, with a small C. It's where I come to make nice things. Today I'm making a nice thing for Alex because I know he's been feeling a bit down for the last couple of years. It's a potato print. It's going to be a bit like that portrait of Myra Hindley, only not as controversial. And what I'm going to do are the words, 'Cheer up, Alex, please.' And if you look carefully, you'll see the words are made up of hundreds of tiny pansies, because we think he might be gay. Well, he hasn't had a girlfriend for years, so I think the writing's on the wall. Oh, not a toilet wall. A nice wall."
"Well, he was always playing with my dolls. He used to drive me mad. Nobody played with my dolls. I didn't play with my dolls. I worked with them. I had a little factory and they made traditional Devonshire fudge by buying in cheaper fudge and repackaging it. He definitely wasn't a normal child."
"I insisted we call our firstborn Rose. Lucky it wasn't a boy, really. But we wanted a rose and we got a rose. Well, she's prickly and she's got quite a red face. It'll do. Alex, on the other hand, I could never really work out what he was for. He helped out in the garden when he was young, but now, well, we have so little in common. I'm professor of symbolics at St Matthew's, Oxford, and he got a high 2-1 from one of the better provincial universities, and he was pleased with that. I suspect he may even have worked for it."
"Is that enough, George?"
"I don't know. What is it?"
"It's shepherd's pie."
"What does it mean, your shepherd's pie?"
"No idea, but I'm sure you're going to tell us."
"Well, normally there's a basic duality, the white of the potato and the dark of the meat. It symbolises Judeo-Christian concepts of good and evil. And yet, the way you make it, Beverly, the two become indistinguishable in a grey mush."
"Really?"
"So, what your shepherd's pie seems to be telling us is that good and evil have collapsed into one another, which could be a liberating release from traditional recipes of law and morality."
"Eat it, George."
"Or it could be just quite bland."
"And how is it for you, Alex?"
"All right."
"What have you done today?"
"Well, I got up about half an hour ago and came down for dinner, and then you asked me what I've done today, and I started this sentence."
"Any word from London?"
"No."
"You're depressed, that's all. Yeah, I made this for you."
"All right. Thanks, Mum. Thanks, Dad."
"Nothing to do with me."
"Look, George, it says, 'Cheer up, Alex, please.'"
"No, it says, 'Are you gay?'"
"Does it? Oh."
"You think I'm gay?"
"No, I don't. But if you were, it wouldn't matter."
"Well, that's great. Thanks. Love the pansies, but I'm not."
"I know. But if you were..."
"I'm not."
"You knew they were pansies."
"I'm not gay."
"Well, what are you?"
I don't know what I am. Always thought I'd work for the BBC after my illustrious debut in broadcasting, reading out a question my dad prepared earlier. Still waiting for that call. They liked my contribution, want to give me my own show. Don't want my own show. I don't want to work in broadcasting. I don't know what I want to do. I have absolutely no idea how I'm going to satisfactorily pass the painfully long time between now and my inevitable death. Which is why I've applied for the PGCE, to be honest. I don't want to be a teacher, but you've got to do something.
What are you doing?
Nothing.
Good.
I'm not touching your roses.
I should hope not. Do you want to do something?
Yes, I'd love to do something. That's what I want. Someone to tell me what to do. In fact, you're my dad. I thought that was your job.
My job is symbolics. But if you want something to do, you can collect a few snails. You know what to do.
Yes.
Good.
Alex, have you got a napkin?
No, I'll be all right.
Pink or blue?
Whatever.
Pink.
I'm not gay.
I know, but if you were...
I'm not...
I'm trying to think.
Oh, don't play with it, George.
It ought to be called cocks in the hole, really, these burnt sausages plunging into the greasy pudding. Why toad in the hole? Why think of our sexual organs as animals, as dark, wrinkled beasts of the night?
George, your son is gay and he can't admit it. Will you please eat your food?
Alex, you're going to have to move out.
What, because I'm gay?
Oh, at last.
I'm not gay.
Ah, no, you just said you were.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you...
I was just trying to get to the bottom of why...
it's all coming out. Oh, coming out.
Dad, are you seriously saying you want me to move out?
I don't want you to move out. In an ideal world, you wouldn't be here.
You want me to move out?
Yes.
I've only been back 3 months.
And there's been nothing but conversation since you got here.
Teacher training starts in 5 weeks. Can you not put up with me till then?
You done those snails yet?
How's it going?
Yeah, got quite a few. Same as last night.
Little bastards. Thanks, Alex. Night.
Well done.
They think this snail killing has given me something to do. I suppose it has. Only I'm not killing them. I'm taking them up to my room. I just wanted to do something for myself. All my life I've been going along this narrow path laid out before me. School, GCSEs, A-level, university. You look behind you and you see this trail, this slow, predictable progress towards the rest of your life. And when you get to the rest of your life, you don't know what to do. The path stops. It's like scouts. I loved scouts. I was a bloody good scout. And when I got to 19, that was it. I was out the door. Beavers, cubs, scouts, venture scouts, then what? Nothing. They lead you to the edge of a cliff and leave you there, and you're supposed to know where to go. Well, I wasn't going to go forward. I'm not stupid. So I went back. Back to my parents' house. Back to rooting around my dad's flower beds for little animals. I've got about 100 of them up in my room now. I should get some sort of aquarium. But it's nice letting them wander about. Do their own thing.
5 strawberry knuckles and a pound of coconut rash, £9.98. 2 pence change. Shall I put it in the tin?
Rose, I didn't actually come in to buy chocolates. I wanted to ask you a favour.
Oh, right. Okay, I'm ready.
Dad doesn't want me living at home anymore, and I haven't got anywhere to go. And you've got this nice, big...
Oh, you know, right. Yeah, of course.
Really?
Yeah, no problem. Borrow the tent. It's in the cupboard in my spare room.
It wasn't the tent I was after.
Right.
It does involve me going into the spare room, but not coming out again, except at meal times.
No, you've lost me.
I want to move in.
Could I give some money to a homeless charity instead?
Look, you'd be doing me a real favour.
Yeah, that's the problem. Oh, I want to do the good thing. You're right, I'm being silly and petty and selfish.
Thanks, Rose.
50 quid a week, plus bills, no pets.
Right.
And you have remembered it's my birthday next week.
Yes. You can say what you like about Rose, but her heart's in the wrong place. It is in the wrong place. It's pressed up against an armpit, which is a very stressful position for a heart to be in. She can't relax, she can't eat chocolates, oh, and she could drop dead at any moment. But she tries to live a normal life. You know, make as much money as possible and sod everyone else.
No, darling.
Oh my God, I think they're doing it. Carol Smiley and Saddam Hussein are doing it. Stupid names, but you've got to call them something. They've been crawling over each other for a while, so I put them in the shag tank. It's an aquarium with cabbage leaves to roll around on and soil.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.